nothing but the blood of.
This conference will now be recorded.
It's great to see everyone out this evening. We are continuing a series of sermons about leadership. And so I'm grateful of the brothers who came before I bring this lesson to talk about leadership. And this is a super, super important topic to know about and to discuss. Reason why is because the world is so off in what the Bible says about what spiritual leadership should look like in the church. And we need to really consider what that looks like as important and as significant. So we're going to try something a little bit different before we get started. And so we'll be looking at several scriptures, but the main scripture that we're looking at when it comes to qualification of leadership in the church will be in 1 Timothy, the third chapter, as well as Titus, the first chapter. This is the type of sermon that is really good to take notes. That's why I did a PowerPoint. There's a lot of meat to it, and I know that it's going to be a high-level overview. The more I studied, the more I realized that we could probably dissect this point by point and make it really an extensive study. But I want to be able to at least give a high-level overview and really distinguish between what thus saith the word says about leadership in the church versus sometimes I think what we see and what we hear, what people think about leadership in the church. So that being said, that the title of today's lesson is Leaders Are Qualified. So we want to consider what leaders must be, not what leaders should be or what we think leaders should be, but what God's word says leaders must be. Leaders are qualified. So when we consider men who are qualified to be leaders, we're not talking about men who have academic accolades. We're not talking about men that have accomplished a lot as far as their profession. We're talking about men who are essentially few and far between. We're talking about men that follow a criteria of what God himself, the Holy Spirit, taught us should be put in place for those who have a desire of leadership in the Lord's church. We can find that even the term who is a man and who is a woman could be a challenging thing for lawyers, for doctors, and for judges to answer today. And so we need to really consider what God's word says about the thing and not what society says. We're not talking about men that have worldly success. We're not talking about men who are qualified to be other things. We're talking about specifically qualifications of the Lord's church. Sometimes we look at men and we admire them. We admire them for who they are and what they've accomplished. We admire them because they're well read or eloquent in speech, or they're charitable. These are all great things. Just because we admire a man doesn't mean they're qualified for leadership in the church. Just because they're well-read or eloquent, dress nice, well-spoken, doesn't always mean that they're meeting the qualifications that God set forth. It can be a really strange thing. It's good because God's word is really clear about it. But when we look at the world around us, we look at many churches and many denominations, we see that what we read is different than what actually occurs. When we look biblically, we see things that are in God's word, but when we look out in the world, we see things that are way different. We'll see things like 25-year-old elders. Are y'all following me? We see things like prerequisites for certain leadership is to never be given a marriage. We see these husband and wife combinations of pastor and co-pastor. These are all kind of things that we see frequently, that we see consistently in the denominational world. And there's a significant distinction between the Lord's church and what we see in the world. And so what is important for us to do is to focus on what we've been studying on consistently through Sunday schools and Wednesday Bible study, is to focus on that which is God-breathed. breathed. We've learned and we've studied that extensively. 2 Timothy 3:16 teaches us that God's word that is God-breathed, is inspired by God. It is profitable for everything. It is profitable for everything. So in everything in the Lord's church, we should look to the God's word as our guide on what we should be doing, not to what the world does and what's common practice in the world and what we feel works well and what we think works okay. We ought to put our own thoughts aside. We ought to focus on that which is breathed by God. After all, we have many examples, right, in God's word on when you don't follow what God explicitly says, how there are horrible consequences, right? From the very fall of man in Genesis, the third chapter, right? God explicitly said, here's what you should do, here's what you shouldn't do. So when we're talking about Adam and Eve in the garden, whether we're talking about Moses when he got frustrated with Israel, right? Whether we consider the priest, Nadab and Abihu, right? God explicitly said, this is what ought to be done. Now, as Christians, we ought to thank God for grace, but when God explicitly says something, we ought to be specific enough to really consider what he's saying and follow it. We don't want to carry the Ark of the Covenant with our hands when God said don't. We don't want to lie to the Holy Spirit by just twisting that truth just enough to where God sees it, God hears it, and God will punish us for it. And so there are many examples, Old Testament and New Testament, on why it's so important. Again, we're not talking about personality. We're not talking about just standards of worldly conduct. We're talking about qualifications that God had put before us. Now, we understand qualifications at its core. We do. We understand it well. We understand it because certain jobs we can't even apply for if we're not qualified. Y'all following me? A while back, I was considering running in the Boston Marathon. Yeah, exactly. I was considering that. And when I considered that, you know what I had to consider? There were qualifications, right? We all can't come in here and just say, oh, we're going to run the best Boston Marathon. It doesn't happen that way. There are qualifications, right? If you're younger, you must clearly register, and you must register by a certain date. Because it's such a large group of people running in this marathon, you actually have to qualify with your time. That means you've had to run a marathon before then, right? You can't be a first-time marathon runner and run the best Boston Marathon. You have to be able to qualify for it. And if you're between 18 and 34 years old, you have to be able to run that marathon at 26 plus miles in 3 hours or less. Y'all following me? And so if we understand that concept, we understand that in order to run a marathon, we have to meet all these criteria. Surely we can understand how much more important it is for the Lord's church. I also understand that because these qualifications are as such as the way they are, as a body, we have a hard time swallowing that. I've talked about this before, and I'm not going to dwell on it. But the state of our country, the state of our culture and our community is not great. We're in a space where the family is disintegrated, where right is no longer right and wrong is no longer wrong, but yet it's switched. And so the world has a huge challenge with the church. The church is really struggling with that. We're seeing a big reflection of the world in the church. But I dare us all to stand confident in God's word. So why in the world is this so important? This is important because it was God's plan. It's God's plan from the very beginning for the church to have elders. This is not a new concept. Titus, the first chapter, verse 5, it says, "For this cause I left thee in Crete, thou shouldst set in order the things that are wanting, and ordain elders in every city, as I had appointed thee." And so it's essentially, it's God's plan. Not only that, but according to Titus, the first chapter, churches without that leadership are described as are in wanting or lacking something. They're still the church, but they're lacking that leadership that the Holy Spirit wants us to have. Because the first century church had elders. Acts the 14th chapter, verse 23, as well as Acts the 20th chapter, verse 28. It says, "So guard yourselves and God's people, feed the shepherd, God's flock, his church, purchased with his own blood, over the Holy Spirit has appointed you as leaders." And so it's also important because when we're doing this, it's not something that we as members of the body are really appointing. When they meet those biblical qualifications, those qualifications that are God-breathed, God's word teaches us that the Holy Spirit is the one that appoints them. Because it comes from that which is God breathed. So it's super important. And so let's go on and continue this. Hebrews 13th chapter, verse 7. It says, "Remember those who rule over you, who have spoken the word of God to you, whose faith follow, considering the outcomes of their conduct." And in the same chapter, if we continue a little further, it says, "Obey those who have rule over you and be submissive, for they watch out for your souls as those who must give an account. Let them do so with joy and not with grief, for it will be unprofitable for you." So Hebrews, the 13th chapter, says that leadership, that elders essentially rule over us, and that we who are faithful should follow considering that outcome, and that we should also be submissive under that authority. Now, those particular scriptures don't use that term, elder, however. God's word makes it really simple that what is being talked about here is leadership in the church. And it's explaining us the importance and the gravity of this particular office. And I know that in our culture today, that being submissive, that being obedient is sometimes scary. It's sometimes scary for us. But we need to follow what God's word says. And so what we see, and this is not an exhaustive thing, but what we've seen throughout the Bible is plurality is a pretty significant part about eldership. When they were appointed back in Genesis, it was a group of them. It was a group of 70 men, elders, that were gathered together in Genesis 18th chapter. We see what we just read in Acts the 14th chapter. Paul was to appoint elders in every city and in every church, Acts 14 and 23. So that's one aspect of it that was super important. The other aspect is really to talk about these terms. There's three terms that we want to look at. We want to look at first, elder. Again, it's just one example, but in the New Testament especially, elders is talked about as presbyters. And essentially those who are mature Christian men. It does talk about those being mature spiritual men. There are some qualifications that give you that say they're older men, right? But it's not just old men. It's mature men, mature Christian men. And we know that because of the context around it when they use the word elder. So Acts 14:23 talks about appointing elders in every church, And in doing that, they prayed with fasting to appoint them to that particular work. The other term that I want us to look at are bishops. Bishops. And when we see bishops in the King James Version, what we see is we see both bishops being used as well as the word overseers being used, which comes from the word, the Greek word episkopos. And essentially had their task was to be oversee the congregation. And so Acts 20, 28 is an example of that. Take heed to yourselves and all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. And then finally, the last term is pastors or pastor. And again, this is a term that we've seen both in the Old Testament as well as New. It talks about shepherding, shepherding. Their task was to shepherd, to feed the flock of God. We've studied about that several times. But what I want us to note is I just want us to point out three scriptures, because what we see in the denominational world, and this is one key thing that separates the Lord Church from the denominational world, is elder, bishop, and pastors are not three separate offices. Oftentimes what we see in the denominational world is we'll see that, you know, they'll have elders that, you know, they'll be elders that are young, or they'll have bishops who kind of have a hierarchy where bishops are over several churches, right? So they teach you there's different levels to those three terms, and God's word doesn't speak to that at all. And so let's just examine that really quickly. Can I get someone to go to Acts the 20th chapter? I get a brother to help me out, Acts 20th chapter, start at verse 17.
Acts 20, verse 17?
Yes, sir.
Acts 20, 17. From Miletus, sorry, he sent to Ephesus. I'm sorry, he sent to Ephesus and called the elders to the church. And when they had come to him.
Stop right there. We're talking about Paul here, and he called for the elders of the church. He's going to skip down. So he's talking to the elders. We're going to skip down to verse 28.
Therefore, take heed to yourselves and to all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. Mm-hmm. For I know this, that after my departure, savage wolves will come among you, not sparing the flock. Also from among yourselves, men will rise up, speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples for themselves. Therefore, watch and remember, for 3 years I did not cease to warn night and day with tears. So now, brethren, I commend you to God.
Stop right there, brother. Stop right there. We're good. So notice in verse 28, he's talking to the elders. He established stats. We got the elders together. He's gathered them together. In verse 28, he tells them to take heed, therefore, to yourselves and to all the flock. So who's over flocks? Shepherds. Over which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers, right? Those same terms are being used here interchangeably while he's talking to the elders. Flock, pastors, Holy Ghost made them overseers, bishops. And then he goes on to talk about the purpose of that pastor, right? He says, for I know this, after my departing, there shall be grievous wolves among you that won't spare the flock, right? So there's a duty there. And so in that one section of scripture shows all those characteristics of that one particular office, that elder, bishop, and pastor. Let's give another example in Titus, the first chapter.
Titus
first chapter, and we're going to start at verse 5.
Titus 1 and 5. For this reason, I left you in Crete, that you should set in order the things that are lacking and appoint elders in every city as I commanded you. If a man...
Go
If a man is blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of dispensation or insubordination. For a bishop must be blameless, a servant of God.
Now see how that just switched? Right? It's the same thing. It's talking about the same thing. He's saying, I set you order to ordain elders in every city. And then he goes for, after these qualifications, he says, for a bishop must be blameless. Keep going, brother.
For a bishop must be blameless as a steward of God, not self-willed, nor quick-tempered, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money, but hospitable. A lover is what is good, sober-minded, just, holy, self-controlled, holding fast the faithful word as he has been taught, that he may be able to, by sound doctrine, both to exhort and convict those who contradict.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. Then the last scripture I want to point out is in 1 Peter.
First Peter.
Yep, First Peter, the fifth chapter, starting verse 1.
First Peter 5:1. The elders who are among you, I exhort, I who am a fellow elder and witness for the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that will be revealed. Shepherds the flock of God which is among you, serving as overseers, not by compulsion, but willingly, not for dishonest gain, but eagerly.
All right. Y'all see that? So again, just three scriptures, basic scriptures that all talk about those three terms in that same office. And essentially what we see these three terms is these are three parts of that same job description, so to speak. Right? So as a leader in the church, one job is for them to be an elder, to be mature. Another aspect is to be an overseer. Another aspect is to both feed and to protect the flock. Right, so they're not three different offices. Really, they're one office that has some different works that are tied to each of those offices. And so, brother, can I get you? We already read 1 Timothy 3. Let's go ahead and read Titus, the first chapter.
Titus 1.
Start at verse 4.
Titus 1:4. To Titus, a true son in our common faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. For this reason, I left you in Crete, that you should set in order things that are lacking, and appoint elders in every city as I commanded you. If a man is blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, and accused and not accused of dispensation or insubordination.
Go back to an elder must be.
For a bishop, must be blameless.
Yep. That's different versions will use a different term.
That's in 1:7.
Mm-hmm. It says it must be. Keep going, brother.
Must be blameless as a steward of God, not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money, but hospitable, a lover of what is good, sober-minded, holy, just, self-controlled, holding fast the faithful word has been taught, that he may be able to, by sound doctrine, both to exhort and convict those who contradict. For there are many insubordinate, both idle talkers and deceivers, especially those of the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole households, teaching things which they not ought to for the sake of dishonest gain. One of them, a prophet of their own, said, Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, lazy gluttons. This testimony is true, therefore, rebuke them sharply, that they may be by sound in the faith, not giving heed to Jewish fables with commandments of men who turn from the truth. To the pure, all things are pure, but to those who are defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure, but even their minds and conscience are defiled. They profess to know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable, disobedient, and disqualified for every good work.
Thank you, brother. Thank you. And so what I want you to see is there's a pattern here in both 1 Timothy as well as Titus. And that is the word must be blameless. Must be blameless, not overbearing, not quick-tempered, not given to drunkenness, not violent or pursuing dishonest gain. Rather, must be hospitable, one who loves that which is good, one who is self-controlled, uprightly, holy, and disciplined. Must hold firmly to the trustworthy message. Right? These aren't suggestions. These are things that must be. And so they must be temperate, being able to deny themselves, being self-controlled, watchful for others. They must be sober, sober-minded, and they must have good behavior. They must not be a novice or a new convert. And that's super important for us to understand. When I was young and I wrestled, what I learned really quickly was they had categories. And one of the categories they had was novice. You guys know why they had that category in a sport like wrestling? Because you could have two kids, same size, one could be way more experienced than the other, right? And the interesting thing about that is if you put someone, you know, same size, you know, same height, and you put them on a mat or in a ring together, one of them can have a way bigger skill set. And so it's important to distinguish that because you can get hurt. You know, people get hurt. And so one of the things that's important is that they must not be a novice. They must not have a quick temper or be hot-handed or impulsive. But they need to be self-willed, not haughty or arrogant or overbearing. After all, those kind of folks people don't want to submit to or don't want to obey. Must not be given to wine. One who essentially drinks wine or other intoxicating drink. Again, these kind of go hand in hand. Must not be one that is apt to fight, quick to fight, or cause strife. Or not quarrelsome, or one that's combative. It must be someone that is peaceful, a man of peace. Greed is a really important thing. That love of money. We know that love of money is the root of all evil. And so they must not be of covetous, you know, wanting lover of material things, but they also must not be greedy, the lover of money. And then here are some that are hard for the church, especially. Must be husband of one wife. Essentially, we're saying husband of one wife. That actually excludes women. Has nothing to do with worth or value. It has to do with the qualification. And so it's saying they must be husband of one wife. So they have to be male. They have to be a man that has one wife. That automatically excludes polygamy. Automatically. It would also exclude those who have been married or remarried after an unscriptural divorce in Matthew 19. And although folks, you know, a man might be technically qualified from his divorce and or remarriage, there are some challenges when dealing with that question. And so that's something we can really dig in and get into more. He must have believing children, children that love, that obey, and that are faithful to God, and that must be of essentially good behavior, modest, and so on. Must be vigilant. That means he must be watchful. After all, part of his job is to watch over the sheep. And so he must be watchful, not over just the sheep, but over his own conduct. Patient, kind, just, which means he's fair and upright in how he deals with others. Gentle, which means essentially he's not unfair, not harsh. And he must be devout, holding fast again to God's word. And dedicated. And then because he is not a novice, he needs to be able to do some things, right? He needs to be able to refute those who are gainsayers, or those who need to be protected from the flock, from false teachers. So we must know what those different teachings are. And therefore, he needs to be apt to teach as well. Blameless, and the thing about blameless, that we don't want to confuse that with being perfect. Because there's no one perfect. If we're looking for fault, we can look for fault, we can find fault in anyone. But it's more being upright, where he's not an immoral person, or where he's not, you know, going around teaching things that are wrong or false doctrine. He must be one that loves that which is good, where he's not wanting to participate in things that are not of God. And he must be given the hospitality. One thing that's really interesting about giving the hospitality is, what I've learned is that men and women clearly are different. And so part of me being given the hospitality has everything to do with my wife. You following me? So that is a characteristic also of not just elders, but of their wife. And they must take heed to themselves and into the doctrine. They may need to be dedicated. They need to rule over their own family well, because if they can't rule over their own family well, how can they rule over the house of God? And then again, they must hold fast, hold on to, respect, stand for, defend, teach God's word. And so essentially, these are qualifications. Many of them are qualifications that all Christians should have, but not all of them. And so there are some really different things that qualify leadership that the Bible talks about that every Christian can't always have. And that is, they have to desire that work. They have to be men, and they have to be married with essentially faithful wife and faithful children. And so that's a high level overview of what leaders not should, not what we think, but what the Bible says what leaders must be. And so that should be our desire as a church, to really strive to care about leadership in the church. And it's something that we should be focused on, not just on the here and now, but especially with our children. We talked about that this morning. Brother Martin preached on it this morning. And so it's important for us to continue to focus on leadership in the church, because if we do that, then our church, the church of our heart, can be what God wants it to be. It be God wants it to be, and be what God expects it to be as the Lord's church. And so to look out among the audience, I do want to extend the Lord's invitation. And so the good news of the gospel is all about Jesus. We talk about qualifications of leadership, but we really need to focus on our leader, the head of the church, which is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If we believe in Jesus, we believe that he died for our sins, and that he was beaten, hung on the cross at Calvary, and he was crucified. And when he died and he was crucified, he conquered death by rising the third day. And if we believe that, we believe in the power of God to not only raise him from the dead, but also to raise us from the dead. We believe in the power of God to not only lift him up, but to lift us up, to save us. And so if we believe that, we need to be willing to repent of our sins, confess and believe that Christ is the Son of God. Because if we confess him now before men, he'll confess us before the Father which is in heaven. And we need to be buried and baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. And when we're buried, that burial, that's killing off an old man, that's literally killing him off so we can rise and walk in newness of life. So if you have not obeyed the good news of the gospel, we have water. There's nothing to stop you from being baptized. We actually do so now. Consider that now while together stand and sing the song. That's selected. Things that are nobler, these have allured my sight. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and hasten glad and free, Jesus. I will come to thee. Thank you, saints, for your patience. Now turn it over to the hands of the brothers.